Because obviously we had the interview the before, and obviously we did that, you know, 20-page Uber spread on Kubrick, I was wondering whether we could just kind of go through a series of stills. Where were you at this moment?
Wandsworth roundabout. Night shoot. Very cold, as you can see from the breath. Brilliant lighting. One huge brute that's cut, it's an underpass, and it was cut there, so you had this incredibly beautiful shot of them first appearing in silhouette, which is really scary. I mean, it's a fantastic shot. You know, the first 20 minutes of this film are incredible because it doesn't give you a pause for breath. It just goes bang, 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 bang. As soon as they leave the Corova Milk Bar, you know, they're into the casino, the rape of this girl is going on, and the big fight with Billy Boy, then into this. I mean, it's incredible. Then you go to, you know, the boys in the car, and then it's into Singing in the Rain sequence. So
it just keeps going, just hits and keeps
going.
It
doesn't give you time to pause. But that was just a cold night out in, you know, underneath in Wandsworth, and it's a beautiful, and I love that actor. I think his name was Paul Farrell. But he was really good and enjoyed it.
And did you do it early on in the shooting of the whole film? Was it, were you aware at this moment this was turning into something?
You do realize it is the 40th anniversary.
Sure.
So do you think I remember when that came in the fucking schedule? No, I don't remember at all. But I think it was sort of towards the latter half. So it was, yeah, in the latter half of the thing. And as we took almost a year to shoot it, then...
I can see why you'd forget.
Yeah,
yeah,
exactly.
Obviously, this is probably the most iconic shot.
Yes.
It's difficult to find one iconic shot from this movie, but...
Those things are called lidlocks. And when he first showed me a picture of a patient with these lidlocks in, I went, ooh, yeah, scary. Yeah. And sort of threw it. He went, no. Look at it and tell me what you think. I went, yeah, scary. You know, but, huh. I went, surely you're not thinking I'm going to do that. He said, oh, yeah, I am. I went, Stanley, this looks dangerous. He said, I have a doctor from Moorfields Eye Hospital who's coming up tomorrow to talk to you about it. I went, there's no way I'm doing that. No way. I mean, I'm an actor. That's torture. That's medieval torture. And, of course, the guy came up, reassured me that there would be no hurt involved, liar. And anyway, we came to do it. And you can see him, he's putting artificial tears into my eyes, which you had to do every 14, 15 seconds or so. Otherwise the corneas dry up, you're blinded. So, you know, they anesthetized my eye, and he was really good. He had all the latest techniques. The corner of his handkerchief, he'd poke in my eye, and I go, God! He'd go, no, it's not, we're not ready yet. And eventually he'd poke it in, and I couldn't feel it, and he goes, right, now we get him in. And these things were, you know, but, you know, they're used on patients who are lying on their back on an operating table, not sitting up watching videos. So, of course, they kept slipping down, and it scratched my corneas. And I didn't know they were scratched until the journey home in the car to my house, and it went over a pothole, and I don't know whether you've scratched corneas, but I tell you, you don't want to do it.
So how long did this whole process take, the whole shoot, for this one scene?
Well, I had them in, I think, only for 10 minutes. That was it, and I had to get it in one, that's it. But of course, being Kubrick, when I eventually got back to work after a couple of days, because the eye is quite quick to heal, he said, I've been looking at the material, I need a pack shot, which is an extreme close-up of the eye. I said, well, hey, how about my stand-in? He's got blue eyes. He went, no, Malcolm, I think people know your eyes. And I went, well, that sucks. So there was a big argy-bargy about whether I'd do it or not, and in the end I had to say I'd do it the last shot of the movie. And I thought, that's never gonna come. He doesn't want to end, he doesn't want to stop shooting, but eventually, of course, it came.
That's one hell of a final day.
Yeah, I had to do it, and of course they scratched again. Because you can't stop it. It's impossible. But it wasn't quite so bad. I didn't need a shot of morphine this time.
Well, thank heaven for small mercies.
Yeah.
Next up.
Pat McGee, Dave Prowse. He was the guy holding me, the bodyguard, was Mr. Universe. And went on, because of him working with Stanley Kubrick, to be Darth Vader. And Pat McGee, who I'd worked with, I was a walk-on at the Royal Shakespeare Company when he was playing Thumping Great Leeds, and just a wonderful, wonderful Irish actor. And great fun, he'd say, there's no fucking beer on this shoot at all. There's no Guinness, nothing. I mean, what is the fucking problem with this man? I'd say, I'm sorry, Pat, I'll talk to him about it. So I went up to Stanley and I went, you know, Pat McGee'd like to have a Guinness with his lunch. I went, I don't want to deal with alcohol. I went, he's not an alcoholic, he's Irish. So he instructed the prop man to buy a case of beer, Guinness. Stanley comes up to me 3 days later, he goes, look, I've been on the prop truck. He's been through every bottle, that's 24 bottles in 3 days. You told me it wasn't an alcoholic. I said, well, maybe he's sharing it with his friends. I don't know.
It's priceless. And finally.
Ah, yes, the great Dildal. That's a lovely penis, no doubt about it. It's a fantastic, they know they're remaking these damn things. Somebody told me that there was in a gallery in New York. I said, you should have bought it. What the hell are you going to do with it? I should have kept it, is what I should have done.